Welcome back, everybody, to Higurashi no Dakokoto ni When They Cry. We are on Chapter 11. This was the first time I'd ever woke up with such clarity. It was 5:59, just moments before my alarm would go off. I was amazed at the precision of my internal clock. I know, I have the same thing. I had made preparations for the next day of school before I went to bed. I changed quickly and descended to the deserted lower floor. It appeared that my mom was still asleep. Neither breakfast nor lunch was ready. Yesterday, I just unilaterally declared that I would be leaving early today, so it couldn't be helped. I slathered jam on some bread and topped it with some instant cocoa. Just as I was finishing up with breakfast, mom rose groggily from her slumber. My Keiji-kun, you're up early. Is there some sort of school event? Not really. Answering bluntly, I picked up my bag and stood after stuffing two slices of bread down my throat. You're leaving already? What about lunch? If you don't wait a bit, I can't make it. If I waited for her to make my lunch, then it would end up being the same time as usual. If I did that, it would raise the chances of me running into Reina and Mion on the way. Yes, from today onwards, I was going to go to school alone. I'll be fine for today. Then what will you do for lunch? I'll slip out and buy some bread or something at the store. Really? Then here's some lunch money. Be sure to bring me back the receipt. I took the 1,000 yen bill for a mom and slipped it into my pocket. It's pretty early. Is Reina-chan up this early as well? No, just me. Did you tell Reina-chan that you're leaving early? I have no reason to tell her every little detail, now do I? Finding it difficult answering the onslaught of questions, I made an annoyed face. Tell Reina that I went ahead when she comes. Hey, Keiji, wait! It's not that I didn't trust my parents. I just couldn't rely on them. They couldn't help me. I could only hope that they didn't get involved. It was safer that way. My mom's annoying voice was cut off by the slam of the door. The first time since I moved here, I headed down the road to school alone. Oh, no. Please no. Please no, Reina.
Right. Reina's gonna be sitting there.
Up until now, I'd always walked down the same path at the same time each day. So I always met with the same people at the same places, but today was different. I didn't meet the people I would normally, and nobody was at the places where I would have normally met them. Of course, Reina wasn't the spot where we usually met, and there wasn't anyone at the spot where we would have met with Mion. The length of the trees, shadows, the morning air, and the brightness of the sun, it was a completely different type of morning from what I was used to. Without a doubt, it felt strange. It left me with the impression that I had destroyed the illusion Hanamizawa had set up for me before it had enough time to prepare all the props needed to deceive me. My, Keiji-kun! You're so early today! Is everyone meeting early this morning? The person who called out me was someone who always passed by as they were taking a walk along the edge of the fields. The name was, I forget. Of course, this wasn't the spot where we usually passed each other. I woke up early today, so I thought it would be a good change of pace. That's all. So I had a random excuse. What about Reina-chan, Mion-chan? Are you by yourself today? Well, yeah. I was being asked the same type of questions my mom was asking. I answered them the same uninteresting, vague manner. It wasn't fun in being asked where Reina was each time I passed by someone. But maybe it was to be expected. It was because for so long we were always together so amicably. Even I felt that if I let my guard down, we could still be friends. Stop it, Keiji. Don't think about that anymore. You spent all day yesterday thinking about how dangerous it was to go soft, didn't you? Beep, beep, beep. A car horn blared from out of nowhere. Even though I was walking lost in thought, that horn was way too close. Mechanical behemoth barreled at me from behind, catching me completely off guard. By the time I turned around, the van's hulking chassis was almost on top of me. I'd seen plenty of cars veer to the opposite shoulder to avoid pedestrians, but this car was doing the opposite. It felt like there was somebody on the opposite shoulder of the van was swerving into my direction to avoid them. That blissfully ignorant train of thought delayed me from realizing something much, much more important. That large mass was hurling right at me. Was it going to hit me? The inside of my head instantly flooded with a painfully cold liquid. In that moment, the scene before me, no, time itself, had frozen. The sounds of that frozen moment, I compared the van, so close I had no way to dodge it, and my body, the upper half, twisted awkwardly in order to look behind me. There was no way I could dive out of my way in my current position. I just lost focus. Now this moment would unpause and would probably be plowed over, caught in a silly pose behind my upper body towards the paddy by the side of the road. If I bent far enough, I'd get away with just being hit by a side view mirror. As soon as the thought crossed my mind, the temporal stasis was shattered by the deafening sound of the van. Side mirror struck my shoulder, sending me spinning off the air like a top, locked in my contorted position. Splash! Sent tumbling through the air, it crashed into the muddy paddy by the side of the road. My entire body was soiled and drenched. The choice I had made in that instant was unmistakably for the best. I was covered in mud, but when the alternative was being hit by the car, it was as close as I could be to being unscathed. Rising out from the paddy, I had enough in me to glare over at the stopped van and yell profanities at the driver. Not sure if he was able to see me, but the van sped off suddenly. Wait, damn it! This was what they call a hit and run, wasn't it? Couldn't help but continue yelling out profanities. The disgrace from being covered in mud hurt me more than physical wounds. I slogged through the muddy paddy and made my way back onto the road. This is a crime, goddammit! Shit! I'll track you down and sue you! If I go looking for a van, I'm sure to find it in this little village. The path I was on had rice paddies on the other side, but it had become so narrow that one car could barely fit through. It wasn't a place you could tear full speed down in a car, let alone pass by pedestrians. Not only was it a narrow road, but the car just now was closer to my side of the road than the other when it went past me. Even as I cursed, I was desperately trying to suppress the dark cloud rolling up within me. This wasn't just a hit and run. That car just now was trying to run me over, wasn't it? Thinking back, it did feel like there had been a car creeping up behind me slowly for a while. That's right. As soon as I'd parted ways with that person taking a walk, I had that feeling the whole time. If it wanted to pass me, then I had no shortage of chances. Normally, I would have felt suspicious and turned around sooner. But I was lost in thought, and now I was kicking myself for not realizing it was there sooner. Then, when the path became narrow and there was no one else in sight, he floored it. If I had hesitated even for a moment, the result would have been no laughing matter. As the adrenaline rush from being nearly run over subsided and the realization of just how terrifying the preceding events were sunk in. There was no doubt about it, that van was intentionally trying to hit me. Cold, viscous sweat seeped down from my scalp and slid down my back before dribbling off. I struggled to avoid falling into a panic. There was still the possibility that this really was just an accident. Calm down, Keiichi. But also don't be so naive, Keiichi. Being that lax will get you killed next time. You need to always be on your toes. Don't give them any openings. My enemy was really out to kill me, the next time they would use a more reliable method. That time came, and I was acting like I was now. I being covered in mud was the price I had to pay for my own naivety. Covered in mud, but without injury. Not even a sprain. I guess this was like what you call a silver lining. I began walking again, this time cautiously. Wouldn't even show a hint of carelessness. I suspected only Rain and the others up until now. No, it was because I had suspected them that I believed there were no other enemies. Oishi-san had said so, didn't he? There was the possibility that all the families of the village were involved. Was I really mired so deeply in this situation that I had no choice but to try and carry on as usual? Wouldn't it be safest just to hole myself up in my house? But the moment I abandoned my regular routine, everyone around me would abandon theirs as well. That was just too horrifying of a thought. I recall the tales Oishi-san told me when Hanamizawa was still called Onigafuchi. A frightening tale of an entire village of demons hunting their prey, surrounding them and eating them alive. One must not interfere with the demons. One must pretend not to see it. The enemy were numerous, all the village families. The villagers with their unwavering faith in the curse would do nothing to help me. A strong, sudden flash of sunshine made me slightly dizzy. I had no idea what was going on anymore. When I suspected it was the work of man, I would catch a glimpse of Oshirosama's curse. And when I suspected it was Oshirosama's curse, someone poked their head out. What was coincidence? What was intentional? Who was my enemy? Who was just a bystander? No, what I truly wanted to know was, how did I end up with the proverbial bullseye painted on my back? Eventually, an answer in a form I could understand will appear. I don't care when that will happen. Because until then, I cannot die. That alone fueled my resolve to keep to fight and will keep me alive.
Well.
Oh, shit. Yes. Damn.
We just got hit by a van.
Everyone's freaking in on it. I'm telling you, man. Water break.
Everyone, right as soon as he said, like he said, right as soon as he passed that guy on the road and was like, you ain't with Reyna?
And it's like, oh fuck, I guess he's out of the routine, go fucking kill him already! I remember seeing the metal bat in the gym storage shed, but there was a padlock on the door barring my entry. At the very least, I wanted to get my hands on it before everyone else arrived at school. I circled around the school grounds impatiently. But all I could find were things like pieces of lumber, anything that could bring me into the classroom easily. Then I had an epiphany. I should search inside the classroom. There was something in the classroom to begin with, and there would be a problem. I could tell that everyone's indoor shoes were still in their lockers. Good thing I came early, nobody else was here yet. I wonder, what could I find in the classroom? I didn't think I could find a specially effective weapon like a bat, but I couldn't be helped at this point. Until the gym storage shed was open, I needed to find a substitute. A lingering hint of naivety whispered that there was no way I'd be attacked at school. But such soft ideas would no longer protect me. I think that they were slowly making their way into parts of my life that I had once thought impenetrable. In the worst case, my own house might not be even safe anymore. That was an incredibly frightening thought. But I believe that, not considering the worst case scenario, would have been even more frightening. Anyways, I will survive. So as long as I live, I will definitely be able to escape this labyrinth of nonsense. Definitely. My exploration of the classroom came to an impasse. It was much to be expected. There was no way there would be anything like that could be a weapon in the classroom. In case of emergency, there would probably be nothing I could do but swing my own chair around. My gaze landed on the lockers that had to be used for personal storage. The locker that Mian used to store her pile of games was among them. There was one for each person in the class, all lined up. Of course, there was one for me as well. Oh yeah, there was supposed to still be a tracksuit in my locker. Seeing me covered in mud would be strange. I should go change later. But first, I needed a weapon. One of my classmates came, it would be hard to rummage through all the lockers. Swiftly began opening the lockers one by one. They're mostly just filled with things like gym clothes, personal items, and umbrellas. An umbrella? If I couldn't find anything better, then this would have to be my weapon. I was about to give up on finding anything decent when I opened a locker that had exactly what I wanted. It was without a doubt a metal bat. It was well worn and pretty beaten up, but there was no doubt it was usable. In that locker that reeked of mold, there also hung a baseball uniform. It was probably the locker of a student in a Pee Wee League. Or something like that. If that was the case, then you'd probably ask for it back. By that time, I could hear the voices of the children scuffling their way noisily in from the hallway. Amongst them, I could make out Rika-chan and Sakuko.
Good morning. My, my, you're quite early this morning, Keiji-san.
I nonchalantly hid the bat I was holding behind me back.
What is with your outfit? You're covered in mud!
Yeah, I had a little incident. I'm gonna change now, so cut me some slack. With that said, I began taking off my clothes. Satoko began to blush, just as I expected her to.
Changing in front of a lady? Have you no tact at all?
I would think that a lady staring at someone who was changing would be the one lacking in tact. There's no changing room for the boys, so just deal with it. As Satoko feigned disgust, she went to the hall, still blushing. Conversely, Rika-chan continued to stare at me, preparing to change. If Rika-chan is a lady as well, then I don't think it would be appropriate for her to be watching.
I'm not a lady, so it's fine.
She deliberately pouted and looked at me with upturned eyes. Then, starting now, you're a lady.
If I'm a lady, then I suppose I must.
So adorable. Rika's still the most adorable. Rika-chan, appearing to be satisfied with being considered a lady, made her way to join Satoko in the hallway.
I can't wait to see scary Rika-chan.
No, I don't want to see scary Rika-chan!
Or Rika-chan to stink you.
Just as I breathed a sigh of relief, Rika-chan stopped suddenly and turned back towards me.
Are you going to start playing baseball?
Seems that Rika-chan had noticed the bat. Yeah, just so you know, I was feeling a bit out of shape, so I thought I'd just try back practicing my swing.
I think it's wonderful you're taking care of your health.
She was talking like an old lady despite her appearance. After saying that, Rika-chan started to leave again, but stopped and looked back at me once more.
Please don't lose that bat.
Seems she already knew that I took it out of someone's locker. There was no name on the locker door. I didn't know whose bat it was, but I would have borrowed it and suddenly complained. Wouldn't be for long. Just until the gym storage shed was open. After quickly changing into the tracksuit, I checked the time. I still had plenty of time before class began, because I came so early. I took the bat in one hand and went out to the schoolyard. That was, of course, to practice my swing. I needed to make it known I would always have a bat on me so I could practice my swing. At some point, the sunlight had become even stronger. Disregarding my classmates as they made their way to school, I took my position in the shadow of the school building. I wasn't the academic type, so I wasn't much of an athlete either. I might get muscle pain if I just suddenly started swinging. Should at least start out with some warm-ups. I doubt anyone would think I was doing something out of the ordinary, which was the exact opposite of my actual mental state. I gripped the bat and swung lightly. The bat was by no means light. The weight would make it a reliable weapon when I needed it to be. Of course, I can only pray that the moment I needed to use this as a weapon would never come. Just carrying it around could deter attacks against me. At least, that's what I hoped. This is getting better, it sounds like.
Huh? Hey, John! What are you doing?
Oh, being bombarded with such a hysterical voice, I jumped.
Well, Keiji-kun, are you on the baseball team? The baseball team?
It was Reina and Mion.
I was surprised to hear you went off ahead. What are you doing, Kei-chan?
Can't you tell by looking? I'm practicing my swing for the championship.
You can say it's part of my diet if you want. Diet? Kei-chan, are you really that fat?
Bet you didn't know. I actually have a beer belly. It's plump and jiggles.
Plump and jiggles?
Reina, you don't have to imagine something weird like that. To disrupt Reina from imagining something like that vulgar, I ruffled her hair muscly.
Well then, I hope you make it to regionals at least. This old man will cheer you on.
Regionally speaking, it seems that Oshima High is pretty strong. They say their southpaw, Kamiya-kun, is amazing. Good luck!
Seems they made me out some kind of local prodigy, but oh well. Well, if I really did make it to the championship, it would be a cinch. After all, I'd be the pitcher and catcher. I pitch the ball and then run past the ball just as I threw and change over to being the catcher in a burst of a super incredible explosive speed. I laughed dryly at the ludicrous image. Coming back to my senses, I smashed the bat against the ground.
What?
Damn it! What am I laughing at? I pounded the ground over and over. With each impact, the reverberation traveling through the bat stung my hands. They made me smile like that. Don't allow anyone close to me. Don't trust anyone. No matter how many times I tell myself that. They made me smile like that again. I already knew quite well that there were demons dwelling in my smiling friends. But I just couldn't believe it. Did that kind of split personality really exist? Like how Reina confessed to the doctor. Were they simply being possessed by Oyashira-sama? In other words, did a supernatural being like Oyashira-sama really exist? And was it possessing everyone to try to kill me? Yeah. That would be wonderful. If only everyone were actually my friends all along and everything was just all Oyashira-sama's fault. Damn fool Keiichi-Marubaru, come on now! I yelled out, drawing out all my power from the pit of my stomach and raised the bat violently into the air. Stop being so soft! As I screamed out with all my might, I beat the metal bat to the ground over and over. With every impact, my weakness was being beaten down. Smash. Forget. Smash. Don't be soft. Smash. Know your enemy. Smash. Like hell I'd let them kill me. My shoulders heaving up and down from my ragged breathing. I heard the first bell ring just as I calmed down. Water break.
He's starting to lose it in his head.
He's getting so paranoid now. But I think it's justified a bit.
Just a little bit.
He's just losing his damn mind from this. I gasped with a sudden realization. That was the final bell. As I felt all the tension drain from me, I let out a deep breath. My mind was in a muddled state for much of the entire day. I didn't feel like I was awake, but didn't feel like I was asleep either. I couldn't say it felt especially comfortable, but I felt a kind of relief that the sanctity of the school part of my daily life had yet to be violated. How long would I have to keep on living like this? I could only grit my teeth and bear with it as this living hell slowly gnawed away at me.
Keiichi-kun, come on! It's club time!
Sound of Reina's voice brought me back to my senses.
Come on, come on, K-chan, stop spacing out. Bring your desk, bring your desk.
I guess it still ran. Everyone was moving their desk together as usual. That's right. It was Happy Fun Club time. But I had no intention of taking part. I've haphazardly stuffed the contents of my desk into my bag as I prepared to go home. It was a weak-handed gesture to avoid having to say it. To actually say I'll be going home now.
What's this, K-chan? You plan on going home right away again?
Mio sounded quite disappointed.
I'm just not in the mood. Could you just let me be over for a while?
Some of the words that spilled from my mouth matched Mio's disapproving glare. It felt like the air in the room had dried out. Satoko looked like she was about to say something, but perhaps dissuaded by the mood. She swallowed her words and stayed silent. Nobody said a thing. I took that to mean that I could leave if I wanted. But the collective gaze of the four of them, like the tiny pins used to mount an insect into display, held me in place. Reina was the one who cut through the heavy mood.
Keiichi-kun, you just didn't like playing with girls, I guess.
She said in such a melancholic tone that it sent a wave of pain racing through my heart. This pain was going to kill me. I wanted it to be the soft part of me that could still feel pain. I tore at my chest, finally tearing out the pins that held me in place. That's not it at all! I'd only been hurting myself by saying anything more, so I swallowed my words. Cutting things off there, I turned away and exited the classroom. They didn't speak a word to me as I left. It was a long, dull trip back home, but I didn't lose focus. I firmly squeezed the grip of the bat, which was already sogged from sweat. Realizing that, I wiped it down with my sleeve. If something were to happen, I wouldn't want it to be slippery. Since this morning, I'd become especially sensitive to the presence of cars. Even while walking, my ears pricked up and sought out threatening sounds and presences that could be closing in. That was why I could hear it. Without a doubt, there were footsteps. Those footsteps had matched up perfectly with mine for a while. What I could sense, it was just one person. But I had no intention of being careless. Did they intend to follow me like that car this morning, until we were in a good location to assault me? It wasn't a good idea to keep walking like this. I stopped walking and looked back. The wooded path crowded with trees and responded with silence that there was nobody there to begin with. But I wouldn't be fooled. I was certain footsteps were following me. Just as I stopped, the footsteps stopped as well. Meaning the person following me wanted to keep their distance. That was, without question, proof that I was their target. I held my breath, waiting for that presence to panic and start moving again. Trees rustled with the sound of the wind. The Higurashi also joined in the dissonant chorus, trying to throw off my focus into disarray. Had 5 minutes passed? Or I'd been like this for a whole 30 minutes? It was so hard to breathe that I might have suffocated. It seemed that I would have been the first one to panic. Without a doubt, he was lurking in the shade of that tree with a bated breath. Then I'd make the first move. I fixed my grip on the bat. I raised it up to my shoulder to be ready to swing it at any time. Hey! I know you're there! With all my might, I screamed at whoever was hiding in the shade of the trees, but the presence in the shade didn't bulge. So the moment I found them, they had no intention of revealing themselves. I know already! I know you're there! I screamed out angrily at them again, but even still, they didn't move at all. Then I'll go over there myself.
Oh no.
With all due vigilance, I approached, step by step. Stepping into the tree's shadow, I saw a human figure there. That figure was curled up like a small animal. Reina! When she realized I had found her, expression softened. She seemed apologetic, but wasn't going to speak a word. Did you have some business with me? I wouldn't accept that silence and screamed the question at her.
Not really, it's just,
Reina was in a panic with tears welling up in her eyes, but it was obvious that she had been following me.
What about the club? Since you're not, I'm not.
That shouldn't matter. Don't mind me and just play.
But I'm just worried about you.
Thinking about how I'd been acting up until now, it wasn't hard to imagine that my behavior could have been perceived as strange. So Reina was concerned. At a quick glance, that's how it would seem. But I wasn't going to let my guard down that easily. If that was really the case, she wouldn't have to do something like try to tail me. She should have called out to me when I was leaving and gone right out with me. But Reina didn't do that. She kept her distance from me and matched my walking speed. On top of that, she matched the sound of her footsteps and deviously tried to hide her presence from me. Then after she realized I know she was there, she held her breath and tried hiding from me. She wore a timid expression that would force one to take pity on her. Without a doubt, she was tailing me. Stop following me. Still glaring at Raina, I continued walking onwards. After I walked for a bit, she ignored my command and began walking again. So I yelled at her once more. I told you not to follow me!
But my house is in the same direction!
Then walk ahead of me. I'll start walking once I can't see you anymore. I moved out of the way and waved my bat violently to urge her forward.
I'd like to go home together with you.
Making a pitiful expression, she meekly squeaked out the words in a voice that she knew would cut into my heart. That agitated me to no end. I knew it was a lie. If you wanted to go home together, then you should have called out to me. Now you're just blurting out random lies.
I'm sorry.
It seemed that the seething anger within me was written all over my face. Even without me saying anything, Raina understood what I was feeling inside. If you get it, then go! I swung the bat, urging her to walk again. Raina looked back and forth between me and the bat and started walking hesitantly, then stopped again. Go on then, hurry!
I'm going! So please stop with the bat! It's scary!
Raina guarded herself while pointing at me holding the bat. She may have realized I wasn't planning on using this bat for baseball. I lowered the bat, but still guardedly opened the way for her. Go. There's no problem now, is there? There was nothing else she could protest. She passed by me timidly, so as not to set me off. As I watched her pass by, she stopped completely after having barely moved at all. Hey, don't stop! Then a powerful gust blew past us, barraging my face with dust. The dust got in my eyes and clouded my vision. While rubbing my eyes with my left hand, I swung blindly with the bat on my right, protecting the small opening I had present. But Raina didn't even try to attack during that opening. Attack me? No, she didn't budge an inch. I could tell from the sound of her fluttering skirt in the wind. As the skirt settled, so did the silence. That moment, the voice inside me immediately warned me of impending danger. I was caught by surprise. The smell of the air had changed. Without me realizing, the air around me suddenly felt like a calamity was about to befall me. It was like the air had suddenly become invisible concrete. Like Raina and I were locked in this space. Raina didn't move an inch. Also unable to move, I stared at her back. Raina was the first to break the silence. Instantly, she altered her stance. Felt like I just witnessed her shift from Raina into that other person who looks like Raina. But the voice voice was one I knew well, which filled me with a kind of bewildering pity. Curiously, I felt relief upon hearing that pitiful voice.
Can I ask you something?
Too shy to even turn around, Raina squeezed her voice out desperately, as she trembled. What?
Why do you have a bat? I wonder?
The question Raina asked was by no means unexpected. I can carry whatever I want.
But you didn't have one up until today. Why so suddenly?
It's all right if I decide to do something suddenly, isn't it? Is it strange that I have a bat?
Because, Gagey, you're not the kind of person to play baseball. It's weird.
I couldn't tell what kind of answer she was looking for, and I was getting tired of answering her. I just suddenly got the urge to play baseball. Is that so weird?
It's weird!
She answered instantly, and that annoyed me slightly. I just suddenly wanted to play baseball. I wanted to practice my swing, so I'm carrying around a bat. What's strange about that?
Strange. Weird. Definitely. Why is Kenji-kun also...
Your ramblings are annoying me. Is it that strange for me to have an interest in sports? Try to sound a bit more threatening to end the conversation. So my suspicions about Raina were cleared, I had no obligation to answer questions.
I'm sorry! Don't get so angry!
Raina still didn't turn around and spat out words of apology, one after the next.
Just one last thing! Tell me one last thing!
I don't feel like talking anymore. Hurry up and go. I yelled loudly at her, causing her to flinch like she had been struck. Seeing her in such a pathetic state caused my heart to ache sorely. Even though she was afraid, she stubbornly kept herself from moving. Before I was able to threaten her again, Raina asked her final question.
Why is that bat the same too?
What did she mean by the bat was the same? I had no idea what she was talking about. What are you saying?
I mean, why is even the bat the same?
I don't understand what you mean at all. Say clearly. Even still, Raina didn't turn around. After inhaling deeply, she screamed,
I mean, why is even the bat the same as Satoshi-kun's?
Satoshi being... Huh?
Oh, no.
Upon hearing the name out of the blue, I became dumbfounded for a brief moment. By Satoshi, did she mean the student who transferred out last year? No, that couldn't be. Raina had tried to cover it up by saying he transferred, but Oishi-san told me quite clearly that he was missing. He was the student who sat up at my seat until last year. He was believed to have been demoned away by Oyashiro-sama's curse. I didn't know the details about his disappearance. The one he lived with was killed the night of the Watanagashi by a drug addict. Not long after that, he suddenly vanished and was now missing. That Satoshi and I were... What? My gaze fell to the bat in my hands. Could it be? Satoshi Hojo. It was a bit difficult to see, but that was what was written on the white tape at the end of the bat. I see, so this was Satoshi's bat. Oh, this was Satoshi's bat. Since nobody was using it, I borrowed it. That's not a problem, is it?
That's not it!
The way Raina said that made it seem like this bat was something that should have never been touched. Like it was some sort of offering at a shrine or a memento of the deceased. I could only stand there, perplexed and unable to respond. Raina continued speaking without waiting for a reply.
Why is it that you're doing the exact same thing Satoshi-kun did when it happened to him?
Raina was talking about more than just the bat belonging to Satoshi.
Hold on. Quick theory, quick guess. Is this all in freaking Keiji's head, and he's the one being cursed? Right now. And nothing is wrong with them. It's just Keiichi.
It's just Keiichi, like, thinking all of these things.
That idea gave me chills. And, like, Oishiro-sama could do that. Just instill, like, these thoughts
into your mind.
Just that idea just gives me chills. Whether it's true or not, that idea gives me chills.
It was the same with Satoshi-kun. He joined a baseball team, but He didn't really like baseball.
What does that have to do with me?
Satoshi-kun also suddenly started walking around with a bat one day. He joined a team, but he wasn't the type to play sports.
What about it? I closed my mouth before I could say that out loud.
Listen carefully, Keiichi. Raina is trying to tell us something important.
Satoshi-kun also one day came to school all day by himself all of a sudden, just like Keiichi-kun. And one day he suddenly started practicing his swing, just like Keiichi-kun. And one day he suddenly began carrying the bat around him, just like Keiichi-kun. And one day he suddenly...
And one day he suddenly... What? Raina had swallowed her words. Raina's sudden silence brought a hush back to the surrounding area. It was then I could finally digest the content of the entire conversation. She was saying my chain of actions was exactly the same as Satoshi's. What's the meaning of this? Up until just now, I'd forgotten all about Satoshi. I'd never paid much thought to him in the first place. Not only that, I didn't even know anything of what he had done. My actions today should have been my own creation after all the planning I had done. But they hadn't been the exact same as Satoshi's? Then Satoshi, no, more importantly, if both Satoshi and I acted the same, then there was a really good possibility that what happened after would be the same. Raina, that day, what happened to Satoshi? Raina knew. She knew what became of Satoshi. No, forget about what happened to a guy in the past. Raina knew what was going to happen to me. Answer me, Raina. Satoshi, what happened to him? With that, I grabbed Raina's shoulder violently and forcibly turned her around to face me. As I faced her, I felt a jolt travel through my entire body.
I told you. Keiichi-kun.
It was that person I didn't know. At least, it definitely wasn't the random Ryugu I'd been talking to up until now. The voice just now didn't have a trace of the trembling or emotion that I had felt had before. The amount of regret I felt for turning around so carelessly was unsurpassed. That gaze that pierced like a cold needle, the smile on her face that invoked an image of having been carved out by a knife. Chills went down my spine, my mind froze under a layer of rime. Both of Reina's eyes pierced through mine, leaving me unable to look away. As if to remind me of the fear from that time before, Reina brought her face close to mine, so close that I could feel her breath. Her face had filled my entire field of vision. Then, her sharply shaped lips grew even sharper, like the curve of a crescent moon, she grinned.
I told you! Keiichi-kun!
After a short pause, Reina repeated the same words again.
Satoshi-kun, you see, transferred out!
Transferred? Meaning what? What Reina meant must have been some new definition of transfer that I'm previously not aware of. My throat and lips dried up, couldn't even acknowledge what I had just heard. All I could do was swallow down my own saliva. It seemed that Reina saw that as a nod. She pulled her gaze back and spryly stepped back 2-3 paces. She did my legs give and I fell to my knees pathetically. Reina and me on my knees underneath her emotionless smile. This had to be a very odd sight indeed. Seeming in that pathetic state, she neither scoffed at me nor held out her hand. But I could neither stand up nor escape with her gaze shooting through my eyes. There was undoubtedly a metal bat in my hand. But right now, it was useless to me. It was like a fly caught in her web. Heavy sweat beaded all over my body. I could feel it dripping from my skin.
But you won't, will you? Keiichi-kun?
Reina finally released me from that cage of time after what felt like an eternity. But her question was missing something important, was incredibly vague. Once again, I swallowed hard, urging her on. Do what? What did she not want me to do?
Transfer.
What does that mean? I don't know what that means.
Is it...
Satoshi and I had... What? All my well-planned actions throughout the day turned out to have been nothing more than a reenactment of what Satoshi had done. Satoshi, had he really been in the same situation I was now? The friends he had gotten along with had changed suddenly and for no reason. At least none that I had noticed. Planned to kill him? Then, fearing for his life as I am, he got a bat to protect himself and carried it around every day to practice his swing? And then one day, he suddenly... He transferred. My blood went cold, causing a prickly sensation to course through my veins. Starting near my heart, it radiated outwards from the top of my head to the soles of my feet, chilling every part of me without recourse. What did she mean by transfer? What did she mean by transfer? Was Satoshi still at wherever he transferred to? Was he the only one who would be able to understand me? Would he be able to tell me why it all ended up like this? More importantly, where did he transfer to? What did she mean by transfer? What did she mean by transfer? Before I knew it, I was at my front door. The frigid knob was hard to turn. Was nobody home? Wasn't that odd of an occurrence? I reached into my pocket and pulled out the single key attached to my first seal keychain. I stepped into the entryway. Just as I was about to take off my shoes, a chill ran down my spine. Someone had entered right behind me, like a classmate messing around, standing right up against my back. You're kidding, right? Had to be my imagination. Logically speaking, it was impossible for someone to be able to hide their presence within my personal space all the way through the door. But there was undoubtedly someone behind me. Hey now, Keiichi. How do you know they're there even though they're behind you? Because I could hear the sound of flowing hair. There's no other reason. I'd hear that sound. That was the presence. Because I could hear the sound of them blinking. Keiichi Marubara, there's no way you could hear that. It was mostly instinct than anything else that was warning me of that presence. Common sense was telling me that it was just my imagination. It was just my imagination. There was nobody behind me. I began to erase the mental image of an eerie figure standing behind me. But at the same time, I asked myself, if there was nobody, then what was I feeling? It was an uncomfortable sensation crawled to my spine. Actually, wouldn't it be better if there was somebody there? If there was nobody there when you turned around, would you be able to accept that? I'd be able to answer all those questions just by looking behind me. But I didn't have enough courage to even do that simple task. Alright, I could try speaking to them. First behind me might answer me. It was a random thought. I didn't care how I went about it, just so long as I didn't have to turn around. If I had calmed down and thought about it, I would have known that it wouldn't have solved anything. But who is it? I spoke in such a hoarse, broken voice that I couldn't believe it was my own. I could almost feel them contemplating their response. I felt it. There's no way I should be able to do that. Calm down, Keiichi. It's all in your head. That time, I was certain I heard it. As if hesitantly trying to answer my inquiry, I was certain I could hear the sound of somebody inhaling. I heard it. I heard it. I heard it clearly. It was a girl. A young girl. I didn't know who, but a tiny speck of courage in me, however reckless it was, inspired a primal yet fitting solution to this current predicament. A scream. All the force of my body released from my lungs through my throat, seizing all thought processes in my head. Expressing all my thoughts and emotions, I began to collapse like a house of cards, somehow managing to twist my body and look back as I did so. It was definitely there. Right there. Somebody was there. So the moment I turned around until I brought the area behind me into my field of vision, they were definitely there. Falling face up, my eyes traced the remnants of the presence suspended in the empty space. It couldn't be. They were invisible. They looked like they weren't there, but they were actually still standing there. As I screamed, all the emotions I was holding back burst free in a violent wave. However, I was decidedly calm as my emotional dam collapsed. The turbulent wave of pent-up emotions was skillfully diverted to a torrent of aggression. That emotion was definitely required to extricate myself from the bizarre situation happening right in front of me. My state of heightened lucidity, I entrusted my body to the fury. The metal bat held firm in my right hand as if drawn there by a magnet. A mid-level sweep would be the hardest attack to dodge. I remember reading something like that from a book about swordsmanship or something. Rah! I brandished my will to fight. The afterimage of all amalgamation of metal flashed as it swung from left to right, beating against the entryway. I don't have a bad feeling about this. Got a bad feeling about this.
Click it.
The bat slammed to the right wall, the tip rebounding violently. Very calmly, I transferred the force of the rebound into a sweep to the left. The door of the shoe cupboard was split into pieces. Those two swings whiffed through empty space, but they seemed to have a great psychological impact on the enemy. I could feel the panic emanating from that space. The attack wasn't the only thing they required. I extracted the bat from the cupboard and it was embedded in it and screamed as I spun my entire body around in a large arc. My scream shook the air, imbuing my ferocious swing with even more destructive power. Crack! Without mercy or restraint, my violent strike was certainly fatal force behind it. Shattered the top of the cupboard. None of my attacks struck the enemy, but my ferocity has certainly seemed to impact them. Breathing heavily, my entire body soaked in sweat. The invisible enemy there, not there, dispersed. When I was certain that the enemy had retreated, I locked the front door and latched the chain. No way had it only feigned retreat and was now inside my house? Once again, I channeled my aggression and searched the house for the presence, but it was gone. Succeeded in fending it off. That moment, the tension drained from my body and let out a deep sigh of relief. All the emotion I had been holding back chaotically merged together and began to flood out. A hodgepodge of fear, accomplishment, and disbelief all mixed together and began to flow through my body. Unable to deal with each individual feeling, I beat them all back the strongest. Exhaustion. Even in this moment, I remained composed. After checking that all the doors throughout the house were locked, I went up to my room on the second floor and closed the curtains. I straightened my back and tilted my head back a little. After clearing my mind of all my idle thoughts, I managed to calm down even more. What was that at the front door? There was definitely something there. Thinking about it, it was just an apparition. I jumped up in my confused state. I really didn't think that was the case. Calm down, Keiichi Marubara. Compose yourself. No matter how calmly I thought about it, what just happened wasn't a figment of my imagination. It was obviously a supernatural phenomenon. Without a doubt, something was behind me. It wasn't some sort of illusion I saw amidst my confusion and disorientation. Proof? I had just one piece. When I asked, "Who is it?" they inhaled as if they were about to answer. That sound had clearly reached my ears. The situation I was in right now was still unclear. I had been possessed by the supernatural phenomenon known as Oyashiro-sama's curse. But this was a ruse by the villagers who had believed in it and were imitating it. Either way, their motives were unclear. Roundabout way it had been done was also still a mystery. If it was perpetrated by humans, that would mean admitting it that it was Reyna and the rest of them were doing it, but that would be solvable. Oishi-san and the rest of the police would surely arrest my enemy. But if it was a manifestation of Oyashiro-sama's curse, I wonder what would happen. Oishi-san very clearly declared that curses didn't exist. At that time, those words were pretty dependable, but as things were now, the rising possibility that the perpetrators were not human. He suddenly seemed quite unreliable. If I told Oishi-san this was work of Oishiro-sama's curse, what would happen? I couldn't imagine his reaction. Would it go without question that a void would expand rapidly between myself and Oishi-san? For me having so few allies to begin with and not being able to confidently declare whether or not this was a curse or not, there was no merit to doing that. I better keep the facts of what just happened at the doorway to myself. It would be better if it didn't add what happened here to the memo behind the clock. There was still ever so slight the possibility that I was actually confused when I thought I was composed, and I was just going berserk in the entryway. How wonderful would that be if it was really what happened? I would be able to refute Oyashiro-sama's curse. If I denied Oyashiro-sama's curse, then that would mean admitting that Reyna and the rest were the perpetrators. If I said that Reyna and the rest weren't the perpetrators, then that would mean believing in Oyashiro-sama's curse. Denying both of those, I would be admitting that I would be losing it. Three options from which I couldn't choose became a trilemma of sorts. They mixed together and formed a whirlpool in my mind, making my head spin. Once again, I straightened myself and leaned my head back slightly to cool myself down. Calm down, Keiichi. Accept what has actually happened as reality. Stop thinking of anything more than that. But I couldn't help but think of it. How wonderful would it would be if it turned out I was just delirious and everything up until now was a figment of my imagination. Are you sure someone's curse wouldn't exist and I would be the bestest buddies with Reyna and the rest? It would have to be crazy. That was the first time in my life I'd ever wished for such a thing.
Wow.
Is that it?
No, it's not it.
It's not it. Fucking long chapter today. The phone rang noisily downstairs. Generally, there were no calls for me, so I never really answered the phone much. Since my parents weren't here, I had no choice. I squirmed off the bed and went downstairs. Hello, this is the Marabara residence. Keiichi, this is Mom. I intuitively had a bad feeling about this. It's because I thought she was going to ask me to go out and buy some things, so I took the initiative. What? I don't mind having instant noodles for dinner. There's still a lot of them. The other day we went out as a family and bought a whole case of cup noodles. I wanted to get a bunch of different kinds actually, but they refused since the individual packs were expensive. So instead I got a whole case of the mega-sized pork bone and ginger flavored ones I liked. My parents don't like the strong flavors and didn't touch any of them, so the cupboards were still full of them. So you see, there really isn't a need to go shopping, right? Keiichi, I'm not asking you to go shopping. Both Mommy and Daddy have to go to Tokyo right now because of work. Huh? Right now? This was really abrupt. No, we're already here. We left this afternoon. It's quite a distance to Tokyo from Anamizawa. Gunning at full speed down the highway would still take 6 hours. Dad has a license, but since he doesn't like the highway, they likely took the train. It would have taken longer. I'm thinking you might understand since you've heard us speaking last night, but it has to do with Daddy's contract. Right now, things aren't going so smoothly. Now that she mentioned it, I did remember that they talked to all the time about how his job prospects weren't looking so good. Daddy is really sensitive about things like this, so if we leave things as they are, it will affect his work. Part of my father's particularly fragile artistic personality, his emotions change as easily as a false sky. You could also just say he couldn't take criticism. But something like that can't be done over the phone! Keiichi, this is your father's job, so can you support him a bit, please? Anyway, it's just faster to talk about it in person, so there wouldn't be any misunderstandings. As their son, there was nothing more I could say once they started talking about work. So we'll be back tomorrow night. Keiichi, will you be fine and wrong? It's not like I'll die or anything. Keiichi, you shouldn't speak so lightly of dying. If there's something troubling you, just talk to us. I believe Mommy will be able to help out. Yesterday, I did bring up if I died rather abruptly, so I suppose they were a little worried. But really, I was more depressed by the fact that nothing would be solved by telling them. But I didn't plan on dying. At least, not while I still knew nothing. I would never allow it. I won't die. I won't. I'll survive even if I have to gnaw my leg off. Yeah. See you then. Tomorrow morning, make sure you wake up. And eat your breakfast. And don't forget to take a bath and brush your teeth. Yeah, see you. Call ended like that. Sometimes my parents went off to Tokyo for business meetings, but Tokyo was far away. They only did things by phone. The times they did go were normally planned out in advance and never happened this suddenly. Could say that those circumstances didn't feel strange or rather unnatural. Anyway, I only needed to recognize the reality of the situation. That tonight, I was the only one in the house. Then when my parents came back from work, I'd be gone. Missing. Vanished. Looking back on the series of events of the previous 5 years involving Oyashiro-sama's curse, it wouldn't seem that strange at all. Come to think of it, it's getting pretty late. I don't think it was good that the only light in the whole house was coming from my room on the second floor. It was the same as broadcasting to the enemy that my parents were gone and this was their chance. First, I ran to the living room, flicked on the lights, turned on the TV onto a reassuring volume. Next was the study. I similarly turned on the lights and some music. With this from the outside, it would look like my parents were here. Once again, I went through the house, checking to see if there was anything left unlocked. When I saw the veranda and the laundry still hanging out there, I went pale. That would have made it too obvious. I needed to take it down. I snatched down the laundry haphazardly and erased all traces that my mother wasn't there. Should be fine now. Ah! The garage! They hadn't gone all the way to Tokyo by car, but they had gone up to Okunomiya Station. The garage was empty, wide open, in a plain sight. This was not good! I panicked and rushed out to the back and closed the normally open garage door. Should be fine now. Ah, I needed to get the paper. Mom always got the paper. Since they left in the afternoon, the evening paper was still out there. My premonition was correct. I pulled out everything from the mailbox and dropped it into the entryway. With this, for sure, this time. Should be fine. Come to think of it, leaving the cupboard busted like that from a little freak out was kind of bad. I'll just say I tripped and fell and the bat I was holding smashed into it. Even so, just leaving it in its current state wasn't good. I should clean it up a little bit before Mom get back and scold me. I remember that there was a broom and dustpan in the closet. I was going to get them. The phone rang once again. Hello, this is Mar Bar Residence. Oh, is this Keiichi-kun? Is your mother around? She isn't here at the moment. You idiot, Keiichi Marabara. Don't reveal that your parents are gone. Oh, this is probably Oishi. You idiot, Keiichi Marabara. Don't reveal that your parents are gone. You can follow up still. Calm down and take care of it. I think she'll be back soon. That wasn't a good response either. Now they may say they'll call again or to tell her to call them when she comes back. Then that's fine. Wasn't anything important. Well then, sorry for the bother. Who was that? Scenario I feared didn't play out, eliciting a sigh of relief. The call was fortunate in more ways than one. I'd have to deal with more telephone calls coming from my parents tonight. I somehow would have dealt with the phone call just now, but I couldn't continue to rely on such poor improvisation. I needed to make up a good story to explain my parents were home, but couldn't answer the phone at the moment. They were making tempura and couldn't step away right now. That wasn't good enough. They were sick and went to bed because they weren't feeling well. Is that going to be safe enough? I was thinking about it on the way back to my room when the phone rang once again. It's like they were calling me because I knew I was going to lie. I didn't want to pick up, but I knew I had to. I suspect my parents weren't here. I should have just taken the phone off the hook under the pretense I didn't realize that it was. Just as the phone rang, I had to pick it up. I prepared myself and lifted up the receiver. Hello? I stopped announcing this was a Maribara residence and I had no reason to be kind to someone I didn't know the identity of. But unlike my uncouth voice, the person on the other side sounded goofy and lighthearted. Hello? My apologies for calling so late. This is... Oh! Now this is Oishi. Hello, my apologies for calling so late. This is Oishi from the Okunomiya bookstore. Oishi-san? Is that you, Marbara-san? Good evening. Good to hear you're doing well. Wait just a moment, please. I grabbed the portable handset and rushed up to my room with it. It was the same no matter where I was, since there was no one else home, but I wanted to be in a spot that just felt a bit safer when I'm speaking on the phone with Oishi-san. Sorry for the wait. How are things? Anything changed since then? Since then? What was that exactly? There was something about that brazen way he talked that rubbed me the wrong way. The last time I spoke with Oishi-san was 2 days ago. The day I stayed home from school, I met with Oishi-san on the way back from the hospital, and we headed into town for lunch and had a talk. And after that, Rina and Mio came to check up on me. When I spoke with Oishi-san, they always knew about it. It was like that since the first time I met him. Today's phone call may well be found out by them as well. Hello? Can you hear me, Marbara-san? Huh? Sorry. What did you say? I asked if anything's changed since last time. It wasn't an answer, so I got a bit worried. Not really. The words stopped in my throat. There's a ton of stuff that happened. All of it, baffling. What should I talk about? I didn't understand any of it, but I should try asking. If I didn't ask now, I may never have another chance. This night when my parents weren't home, I had no guarantees I would make it through the night safely after all. Well, Oishi-san, it seems that someone is after me. Really? It could all just be a coincidence. But the day I missed school when I was sick, the two of them came to check up on me.
Which two?
Reina and Mio. They started asking about how I had lunch with you.
What next?
They left me some mochi when they came to visit, but there was a needle inside. Fortunately, I somehow didn't swallow it. I wonder, could that have just been a threat?
About the needle.
It was just one of those common sewing needles you see all the time.
Oh, okay. About the needle.
There was a hole to thread string through.
Not that, Marbara-san. The needle itself. That's evidence. It could be used as proof that they threatened you. Where's that needle?
That's right. That's it. I dropped the receiver and rushed downstairs. When I tossed the mochi, I had overlooked it out of terror, but that needle was a valuable piece of evidence. I'd certainly thrown the mochi and needle at the wall together. If it was there, then it would be on the living room wall. When my prudent mother had cleaned that living room wall, there was not a trace of mochi left on it. Could it be that it dropped in the gap between the wall and the carpet? I frantically searched by running my palm along the carpet, but nothing turned up. I tried moving around the sofa and desk, pulling up the carpet and flapping it around. I couldn't find the needle. Did Mom clean up everything without noticing it? Just 2 days ago, I didn't know what day they collected the burnable trash, but it may still be in the trash bin in the kitchen. I rushed to the kitchen, opened up the lid of the pail, and poured out all the contents. But even at a glance, I could tell that it would be incredibly difficult to find the needle in this pile of trash. I was looking for a needle in a trash stack. I know. I'll try running my hand through it. It was a bit gross, but I was looking for the needle. If I felt a small prick, I'd be able to find it. It was a pretty tactless method, but it was the quickest. All my breath had started striking the pile with the trash in my hand. Phil flew about. There was nothing more disgusting than this, but it was not the time to be concerned about such details. Continued on for a while, but nothing turned up. I wanted to search more thoroughly, but I was still on the phone. Shouldn't keep Oishi-san waiting for too long. Later, when Mom got back, I'd have to ask her if there was a needle. I just began scribbling on the notepad to fix the refrigerator with a magnet. Was there a needle? I scrawled the words with a red pen. I then dashed back up the stairs where I had been keeping Oishi-san waiting for too long. Hello? How did it go? I couldn't find it. I was really overwhelmed back then and...
I see. It'd be great if you could find it. Keep it safe.
That's right. The needle wasn't the only incident. I had to tell him about this morning with the hit and run. Also, Oishi-san, that isn't all. Actually, this morning, that van was definitely aiming for me. I could say that without question due to the circumstances at that time.
Did you see the license plate?
I can search for it from here. Damn! I just flipped out yelling at him back then, but I didn't look at his plate. What failures on my part with the needle and the plate number. I was so focused on just protecting myself that I let out some of the most important details slip out of my grasp. Punched my pillow, annoyed at how worthless I was. I'm sorry, I don't know much more than that. It was a white van. Nothing to fret about Marabara-san. Anyone would be shaken up after being hit. I guess all this really isn't a coincidence, is it? Huh? Oishi-san started to hem and haw over at the other end. I can imagine him folding his arms. Also, Reina's acting strange. How so? What Reina said on the way home today, asking why I was so much like Satoshi-kun. Now I could say it with confidence that Reina knew what happened to Satoshi. She knew that there was much more to him than just simply disappearing. Reina knows. She knows something regarding what happened to Satoshi, the kid who was demoned away last year. What would that be exactly? Reina said, I was the same as Satoshi. She said something to the effect that the way things are going, I'll end up with the same fate as Satoshi. Fate, you say? It's like, what kind of fate did she say befall on you? Transferring out, she said. Transferring out? Reina said Satoshi transferred out. So given how things are with me, I'll transfer out too. Oishi-san let out a stern sigh and then grumbled loudly. Marabara-san, that was probably some sort of threat or maybe some type of warning. I thought so too. At that point, I started to think. Would it be prudent to sum up everything that had happened up until now as the machinations of some human perpetrator? Other than the theory of it being Reina and the others, I was left with Oishi-san's curse actually existing as the only other explanation. Of course, I couldn't tell that to Oishi-san.
Water break real quick.
Oh man, this is crazy.
Holy shit, my mouth is dry.
So much knowledge. It's hurting my brain.
Except Reina's strange behavior could be proof of either scenarios. Whether it was Oyashiro-sama's curse being real or everything being part of a conspiracy committed by all the villagers, Reina was involved. Reina had to know something. Reina was suspicious. What exactly was Reina? Couldn't help but thinking she was somehow involved with the prior strings of mysterious deaths. Seemed to recall that Oishi-san had admitted that he had dug into Reina's past a little. He's probably just downplaying it when he said of little, meaning he had actually dug pretty deep, most likely. I wanted to hear about Reina. I wanted to know what happened at her previous school, among other things that were still unknown to me. If Reina was somebody I should suspect... Oh, not that. I wanted to know the truth. Tonight, I was alone in this huge house. Even though I said I couldn't count on them, I had lost the security I felt I had just by my parents being around. It wasn't like this house was some sort of fortress or castle. If a malicious person decided to use brute force, they'd easily gain entry. There were no other residences close to the Marabara residence. No one would be able to hear anything, no matter how loud it was. I never felt as much resentment towards my father's artistic temperament and the fact that he had this house built in such a remote location as I did right now. I wondered if I would still hear by tomorrow morning. So I had to ask. Right now. Because I had no idea when the chance would come. Oishi-san, I have something I wanted to ask about. Please don't keep anything from me. Sure, ask away. Even though he was so far away from the other end of the line, this was the most reliable he had ever felt. I wanted to ask about Reina. What would have happened at her previous school? Actually, regarding Reina's... I noticed a sound that had been going on for a while now. Since I was so focused on the call, I hadn't paid attention at first, but finally realized it was the doorbell. The time was 7 o'clock. It was past the time the postman would be bringing delivery, and past any sensible time for a neighbor to be visiting. I considered just acting like nobody's home, but that wouldn't be good. That would ruin all the work I put into making it look like my parents were home. I need to answer the door. Hello? Marabara-san? Sorry, someone seems to be at the door. I'm going to go see who it is. I guess. I see. My apologies. Should we end this phone call now? That would be a problem. No, I'll be back in a second. Do you mind if I just leave the phone on? It's fine, I don't mind. I dropped the handset on my bed and dashed down the door. I needed to make up a good excuse to get them to leave. I had a hunch it was the lady who called right before Oishi-san did. In which case, it would be one of the neighbors who's friends with my mom. I'll just say mom isn't feeling well and went to bed early. That would be the easiest option.
It's gonna be... Reina or Mion or all of them, and
it'd be hard for her to ask me to wake up my mom if she's not feeling well. They'll continue to ring us at regular intervals. Someone didn't answer after you ring the bell so much, you normally give up and go home, wouldn't you? Without removing the chain, I opened the door slightly and peered out at the visitor. Chill ran down my spine. I knew it. Somewhere deep inside, I had prepared for this moment. I tried to escape by imagining it was the easiest person to deal with, one of my mom's friends.
Good evening!
Reina! There shouldn't be any reason for Reina to come over at this hour. The timing also made me feel uneasy, because it was just as I was about to ask Oishi-san about Reina. I just could have chalked this up to mere coincidence. Those unsettling words from Mion several days ago echoed back to me. There's nothing this old man doesn't know.
Yeah.
Are you alone?
Are you alone, Reina?
Yeah.
It seems that Mion wasn't with her, but that didn't change the situation at all. Why did you come here?
Hey, Kichikun! I'd like you to open the door so we can talk. Can I come inside, I wonder?
It's true that speaking through a chain door wasn't the right way to talk to a classmate. But at my house, the chain has to be on at night. Don't worry about it.
Then it can't be helped, I guess.
Reina pouted rather sadly. But she kept on smiling at least, and her effort to keep that smile up was quite pitiful. Even though she was tugging at my heartstrings, I didn't lower my guard. As long as I stayed like this, even if it made my heart ache, my life wasn't in danger. What I really feared, more than the possibility that hoodlums would assault me if I removed the chain, was trusting Reina enough to remove the chain, having my friendship betrayed. As long as the chain wasn't unlatched, even if it was made my heart ache, I wouldn't have to deal with being betrayed by Reina. Since it didn't seem like I'd removed the chain from her silent urging, she appeared to give up on trying to get into the entryway.
Have you eaten yet, Kichiko?
No, I haven't eaten. Since my mom wasn't there, dinner wouldn't be ready no matter how long I waited. I laid down when I got home, was woken up by the phone, and didn't have a chance to eat since I used up all that time talking. I was gonna have cup noodles in any case, I'd just eat one whenever I wanted to. No, not yet. What about it?
I'm good! Look here! I brought a bunch of dishes!
Reina held out a stack of boxes wrapped in a cloth.
Yeah, if I can use your kitchen, I can heat up the miso soup and other stuff.
It's fine. You don't need to do that.
But there's a lot of tofu and vegetables in it. Has Kichi gotten like this stuff? I wonder.
There's no way I wouldn't like that. I love miso soup with lots of ingredients. White radish, carrots, burdock root, and potatoes, dense and fibrous root vegetables. Yeah, that miso soup looks incredible.
I also brought rice, so if you microwave it, you can eat it really quickly.
Without a doubt, rice needs some miso soup. Stuffing rice down your gullet, sipping miso soup in between ravenous bites. Oh yes, how wonderful it is to be born Japanese.
Also, I made some more pickles. I made sansai pickles this time.
Before I moved here to Hamizawa, I scoffed at the mountain vegetables called sansai. But I was captivated by their charm the first time I tried them. Such a deep yet light flavor. Vegetables from the supermarket were tasteless and bland compared to those. If he had to describe them, then they were the vegetables for the uninitiated. To be an expert such as myself, you first had to partake in sansai. It was common knowledge around here, that the Ryugu family's tradition of pickles were wonderfully delicious. No matter what kind of pickles they were, they'd go so well with that fluffy white rice.
And also...
But wait, there's more. So delicious, it just seems so delicious. Farewell to my unhealthy self who said he'd make do with cup noodles. Reina appeared to be in good spirits as she was offering such a delicious sounding dinner. Stress evaporated from my gut and hunger revered its ferocious head. At the same time, my wariness of Reina suddenly dwindled. Reina did say she was alone. Shouldn't be a problem letting her inside, though the possibility that it was laced with poison still hadn't been ruled out. That moment, a cold chill ran down my spine once again. Couldn't understand why such a sensation occurred just then. But the voice inside me was sounding the alarm. This happy Reina, speaking of this charming dinner, was dependent on one premise. And that premise was that tonight dinner had not been made at my house, meaning it was under the assumption that my mom, who should be making it, wasn't here. At any normal household, 7 o'clock would be around the middle of dinner time. If my mom were here, we'd be eating dinner around this time as well. The fact that she brought over the makings of the meal at this time was inherently strange. Unless she knew. Reina. Did she know that my parents weren't home? But there was also the chance that this was a bluff. I turned on the lights and a bunch of other stuff to make it seem like my parents weren't here. There was a chance that Raina was unsure if my parents were home. But I had to wonder. The laundry, the garage, the evening paper, there were plenty of signs of them being hastily tidied up. It's hard to say that Raina didn't have a chance to determine if my parents were here or not, but there was no reason for me to confess that right now. I just tried holding on to the fact that as long as I could, first of all, the chain was still latched. As long as it didn't take it off, Raina would be able to do anything to me. I'm quite grateful, but dinner will be ready pretty soon.
Huh? Is that so? Is that so?
I know you went through all the effort and everything, but, well, I'm able to think of a good way to refuse my words trailed off weakly.
But some of this could work as side dishes, I think.
I'm sorry, we have more than enough already. My mom always makes quite a few side dishes, so...
Well, we have the side dishes...
The smile that bordered on a cringe, I dodged her questions apologetically. But the feeling I tried to ignore began creeping up on my back again. I spoke as if my mom was setting down dinner right now, but didn't mesh well with that what Raina was saying. Raina was talking as if she was aware of some obvious fact, and that I was aware of it as well.
So, Kichigun could cook. What did you make, I wonder?
No. Well, it's not that I... Raina had assumed out of nowhere that I had made the dishes. No, not so much that I had made them, but rather, my mom hadn't.
Did you really make them? The side dishes? Did you, Keiji-kun?
It wasn't me who made them. My mom did. No, she's making them, right now. So you see, I'm sorry, but I can't eat what you brought. Raina fell silent at that moment. That moment, I felt the light had suddenly disappeared from her eyes.
How about I try guessing what Keiji-kun's dinner will be?
It doesn't matter what I'm going to eat.
Let's see...
The conversation might appear natural at first glance, but Raina was firmly in control. Felt like I was being interrogated.
Your dinner. I wonder, is this something that can be made with just hot water?
Hey now, stop with the insults. I can't believe you belittle my mom's extravagant dinner like that. Tickets sold out, full capacity already. It's that amazing. Tried my best to put on a strong front, but I couldn't grip my teeth quite right. So instead, I looked like someone who was borderline hysterical. Raina showed no reaction whatsoever, even to that silliness.
Keiji-kun, did your mother really leave you dinner?
No, she didn't leave me dinner. She's making it right now. It's almost time for dinner. Raina had taken that assertion of mine, that my mother was home and making dinner right now, was completely ignoring it. I could tell that the more I panted, the colder Raina became.
Hey, Keiji-kun.
That moment, an uncomfortable chill crept up from the gap in the doorway.
Is your mom home, I wonder?
I couldn't keep up this charade anymore. Raina, she knew full well that my parents weren't home, but I've come too far to admit that now. Anyway, my parents were here, and we'd be having dinner soon. That's the situation I concocted. So I answered, until she was here. She's here, of course. I could feel the humidity drying out from the surrounding air. Raina's eyes were becoming even more frigid, piercing me with that gelid glare.
Why?
What do you mean? I tried to be casual, but the facade was torn off me the instant I looked into Raina's eyes. That look, it informed me of Raina's response faster than she could open her mouth.
Why have you been lying to me, I wonder?
I'm not lying.
That's a lie, isn't it?
It's not a lie. Lies! Raina's outburst sent a jolt surging through my body. Raina and I were still separated by what few inches that slightly ajar but still chained door could afford. And despite that, I was still being cornered. My house, which I considered a safe haven until now, had become more like a dark alley where no one can save me.
Shall I guess your dinner, Keiji-kun? Let's see...
I knew that Raina now. I'd already known that my parents would not be here tonight. But it was still so strange that it had come to this. If she somehow knew that my parents weren't home, there was no way she could be able to guess what I'd be eating tonight. But Raina said she'd guess. Did she guess it? She knew it was instant.
Cup noodles. That's right, isn't it?
That I was going to eat. Wait. The cooking repertoire of a man who can't do housework is probably nothing but cup noodles after all. Looking at this statistically, it was the most probable answer. I didn't mean she was guessing.
I don't think you'll be full with just cup noodles. I think having rice and stuff will be definitely in the spot.
Calm down, Cage Marmara. This was just coincidence. Raina was just reading certain details of mine. So the fact that she was inferring that I was thinking alarmed me. But it wasn't as if she was actually reading my mind. If it was being read, then she was a demon. No, not a demon. Things like that. It couldn't possibly exist.
Do you like them?
Do you mean noodles?
No.
Raina indicated that the point my answer was addressing was wrong. The rebuttal was so short that I momentarily didn't understand the words I'd spoken. Sorry, Raina. What did you say just now?
Huh? About what?
Just now, you asked me if there was something like that I liked, didn't you? It was long before I regretted how carelessly I pushed forward with that question. Such a simple answer that was why I wasn't able to comprehend it.
Pork bone and ginger flavor.
Oh. I wondered how I appeared in the moments my mind went completely blank until the moment I was able to recover. As my field of view began to distort, slowly swirling in a counterclockwise direction, I lost all sense of balance.
Why do you know that?
I didn't even deny it. That was the type of frenzied state I was in. How could Raina know even this? Not even caring as I mashed my head against the door, I fixated my gaze on Raina. But she didn't even flinch when she saw me do that. I certainly did buy them. I bought a bunch at once. I bought a whole case. How could you know that?
Why, I wonder. Quite strange, isn't it? Isn't it? How could you
dodge the question at a time like this? The chain of the door suddenly were no longer protecting me. How did you know? Why do you know? Answer me!
You bought them at 7th Mart, didn't you?
Shiver ran up my spine. I tried covering up with an angry facade. Like I said, why do you know that?
I was behind you, following you the whole time.
What are you saying? I couldn't understand why she was saying she'd been following me all this time.
That's because Raina was right behind Keiji Kun's back the whole time.
like that night? Then I was absorbed in my conversation with Oishi-san. I didn't even sense her being there, standing behind the door, behind me, standing there. Just like that?
When Keiji-kun was picking up the noodles, I was watching the entire time. You picked out so many different flavors, didn't you? Then your mom got angry. If you're going to pick the expensive ones, then you should just pick one type, she said. Then Keiji-kun picked out that big box of pork bone and ginger flavor that he loved so much, didn't he? I like it too. Pork bone noodles. But I can never eat a big whole bowl myself.
My brain was paralyzed, dulling my senses. It might have been a defense mechanism to diminish the fear I was feeling to non-traumatizing levels. The fear being diminished, the fog enveloping my mind was cleared away. Then, I couldn't understand what Raina was saying and started to put meaning behind her words. Even so, my fear hadn't subsided completely. It was like I was standing at the edge of a cliff. Eyes closed, so I didn't have to look down. It didn't actually solve any of the basic problems. I slowly took a step backwards. As I withdrew, Raina advanced.
So, Keiji-kun, can you open this? We can eat dinner together.
You have to invite demons into your home.
That's vampires.
That's demons.
I'm only aware of that being with vampires.
I'm sure it's going to be delicious, so... okay?
Reina's pale, slender fingers squirmed through the crack in the door, one at a time as if they had mind of their own, rattling the chain. She had unlatched the chain from the door, feeling of terror would just explode within me. But Reina didn't do that. She was simply imploring me to remove the chain. She was doing her hardest to light the fuse to the powder keg in my heart, trying again and again. Clatter, clatter. But it doesn't light. It doesn't light.
Open up! Keiji-kun!
Please go away. I beg you, please go away!
How can you say something so mean, I wonder? I wonder...
Please go away! Go away! Go away! Powder keg inside me finally went off. No smoldering. It just exploded. I tackled the door. The force of the door had knocked Reina momentarily off balance. Couldn't hesitate here. I grabbed onto the doorknob with both hands, planted my feet firmly, and pulled with all my might. Less slamming sound, so I desired it didn't happen. I could feel a tiny, disturbing bit of resistance keeping the door from closing. And the source of that was Reina's fingers. Each of those fingers were wriggling, squirming around like tendrils of carnivorous plant through the crack in the doorway.
It hurts! It hurts, Keiji-kun! It hurts!
It wasn't a harsh shriek, but more of a yelp she was trying to keep back. Away! Away! Go away! I kept on pulling on the door with all my might. Didn't even realize that I didn't loosen my pull on the door, at least momentarily. Reina wouldn't be able to pull her fingers out, and that was why the door wasn't closing.
It really hurts, Keiji-kun! I'm sorry if I was messing around too much.
I didn't care one bit for her apology. No matter how much she apologized, it didn't change it. Any of what she had done up until now. Didn't change anything.
It hurts! It hurts! I'm sorry! I'm sorry! I'm sorry!
Go away! Go away! Go away! Reina couldn't leave even if she wanted to, because I had trapped her fingers. Reina's white fingers became deep red and were no longer even squirming.
Ooh. I'm sorry! I'm sorry! I'm sorry!
Go away! Go away! Go away!
I'm sorry! I'm sorry! I'm sorry! I'm sorry! I'm sorry! I'm sorry!
Reina's apologies were occasionally twisted with pain. Like a broken record, she was intent on repeating it over and over. Go away, go away, go away, stop it, stop it, stop it, stop it! I pulled on the door even harder. Finally, Reina's fingers were somehow able to slip out from their imprisonment in the doorway. The moment that happened, the door closed soundly. I could hear the thud of Reina falling in her butt on the other side. I locked the door immediately. It made a loud clunk, voicing my rejection to Reina.
I'm sorry, I'm sorry, I'm sorry, I'm sorry! Keiji-kun, I'm sorry! Open up, Keiji-kun!
Reina leaned up against the door, apologizing profusely and nothing else. To confirm me that I was sufficiently sealed off from her, I trudged away from the entryway. On the other side, I could still hear Reina echoing her apology. I'm sorry, those pitiful words, they would never be forever seeking my forgiveness. I didn't feel bad about this at all. That wasn't any sort of malice. I felt a sort of hazy sense of relief that I was able to escape from Reina. Before, Mion had threatened me at this doorway, saying there was nothing she didn't know. Just now, at the same place, Reina told me the same thing. My feeble attempts to disguise the fact my parents weren't home had served no purpose from the start. I should have just pretended to be out, not even opened the door. My meager plans hadn't helped at all. Nanami-zawa was impossible to outwit them. But even though I was on the other side of the door, I wanted to get as far away from Reina as possible. One step, two steps. With each one, her sniffling apologies became more distant. I sprinted up the stairs and dove into my room. As you would expect, I was finally no longer able to hear Reina repeat her endless apology. Diving into my bed, I was startled by a hard lump I felt. There was something in my bed?
The phone.
It was the receiver. I finally remembered. I was in the middle of a phone call with Oishi-san. Looking at the clock, apparently not much time had passed since I went downstairs. Maybe that my clock had run out of batteries? I talked with Reina for so long. I don't almost know time pass. Man, the clock was ticking forward 1 second every second as usual. As I put the still warm receiver to my ear, time, which felt frozen, began to move once again. Hello, Oishi-san! Sorry to keep you waiting. No, not at all, I didn't wait that long. It became apparent that the amount of time that had passed between myself and Oishi-san was different. For the phone, I could feel an energetic voice from a sports program or something. Drove home just how far away Oshi-san really was. Rainy came just now. Did she come to play? I wasn't confident that I could clearly explain the situation to Oishi-san, but I didn't need to right now. Right now, I needed to know about Reina. That's right, I was planning to ask Oishi-san more about Reina, but Reina's little visit interrupted that conversation. What was true and what was false, I couldn't tell. The one thing I knew was the single grin reality that Reina was suspicious. I might be able to figure out something if I had asked Oishi-san about her. Up until now, I regretted it whenever I forced myself to ask about things I was better off not knowing. But looking at it that way, I say I only hit rock bottom. There was no possible way I could feel any more regret than I did now. No, rather, I wanted to know if there was anything beyond this I would regret more. Forget about tomorrow. It wasn't out of the realm of possibility for something to happen tonight. I wanted to know everything I could. I was absolutely not going to die like this. Not without knowing anything. I definitely won't. Regarding Reina and Ryugu-san, I did a bit of digging. Yeah, well, it wasn't much. I understood how Oishi-san was talking in circles. A bit, mean, I dug so deep it would be hard to discuss with since your friend you're here. I want to know everything from your research. I don't think you'll be very interested in what I have to say, though. Oishi-san! I spoke as calmly as possible to Oishi-san, who was continuing to avoid the issue. Then I said it. I think Rei and Ryugu is suspicious. Even if the past incidents were from Oishisaru's curse, Reina Ryugu is involved! Do you have some sort of proof that makes you believe Reina-san is suspicious? The manner in which Oishisaru spoke became very firm. Do you have some sort of proof? That was him talking as a detective. I only have circumstantial evidence. I see. I could tell even over the phone how disappointed Oishisaru was. Along in the fishing line, when he felt a bite, only to reel in the bait, disappointed but ready to cast the line once more, that's how it seemed. Oishi-san, you can't do anything without physical proof, can you? What I meant was, you can't come and save me without proof. I stuck that barb in there. As Oishi-san loved roundabout ways of saying things, he understood me just fine. It's fine, Maribara-san. I'll protect you. That was not the least bit reassuring. Oishi-san was just using me to continue his investigation. I was just going to be killed, and my corpse would be an important piece of evidence. That was all I was to him. Whether I'm alive or dead may be of no concern to your investigation, but it's all over for me when I die. Oishi-san went silent on the other end of the line. That may have been too blunt, but I didn't care. All I needed to relay to Oishi-san was that I was currently in a very dangerous position. So please, tell me. Tell me about Reina. Satoshi transferred out. Not too far in the future, I'll probably do what Reina called transferring out as well. But you won't be able to find my corpse. You haven't been able to find Satoshi's body yet. Alright, Maribara-san, please calm down. I was already suppressing my agitation, even without Oishi-san having to tell me. I wouldn't solve anything if I continued to scream about my mistrust in the police. It would seem that I could only depend on myself and the bat Satoshi left behind to protect myself. Then I, at least, wanted to know about what happened before Reina transferred schools. You're aware that this won't be very interesting, right? Oishi-san, realizing my resolve couldn't be swayed, finally caved. Right now, to me, there is nothing that I'll find uninteresting. Please, there are a few things I need you to agree to, okay? Okay. Please keep this confidential. Also, part of this may be speculation. Not all of it may be true. Are you still interested? It might not be true. I understand what you mean. There isn't one main investigation for the mysterious chain of deaths in Namizawa. Each one is treated as its own individual case. This Reina Ryugu has never been linked to any of the investigations. Basically, you see, this isn't an investigation of Reina done by the police. It is a personal inquiry, is what you're telling me. This will make things a lot quicker since you understand. All this from either phone calls or meetings and interviews. So they aren't corroborated. I'm asking you to take this all with a grain of salt, is what I mean. Do you have an agreement? All of it is just from what you've heard? Yes, my apologies. It's all my personal investigation, you see. That thing before, you said you saw Raina's chart, didn't you? I'm sure I heard you say that. Voice is on pause for a moment on the other end of the line. I told you that too? Ha! Please pretend you didn't hear anything about that. I didn't care about Oishi-san having certain obligations and responsibilities. I wasn't even care if there was no proof. If there were just rumors, there's no smoke without fire after all. Please tell me, Oishi-san. Understood. Oishi-san finally opened those, like, tight lips of his. It seemed that Raina lived in Hanamizawa a long time ago. She had moved to Ibaraki Prefecture after she finished elementary school. And following that, right after transferring, the unfortunate incident with the breaking of the school windows happened. Then Raina confided to the doctor. It was Oyashiro-sama. This was all that he knew. There isn't much difference between what I know and what you know, Marubara-san. But what part did you investigate further? I didn't need to ask. It was the incident that happened just after she transferred. The incident Raina was responsible for, and what she divulged to the doctor afterwards, correct? Yes. After you learned about that, you started suspecting Raina and the others, didn't you? Yes, I did suspect them. So they're the ones after all? No. That's not what I meant by suspect them. Huh? Oishi-san was the type of person to say things with confidence, but these particular words were less than reassuring. Then who did you suspect? That it was Oyashiro-sama. Huh? That Oyashiro-sama's curse really exists. Yeah, alright. Well, Oishi-san's laugh was quite dry, certainly not the kind that would make you want to join in. Oishi-san resumed the conversation, about the dubious circumstances behind Satoshi's disappearance. The course of events up until the start of delving into Raina's past. Just then there was a thunder in the distance, and heavy rain started pouring down.
Oh no.
It came without warning. Rain so heavy it felt like it could beat you down. I had left the window in my room open a crack to let the heat out. The violent wind danced in my room, making the curtains flap wildly. What is it? Nothing. It just started raining heavily. Sorry, please continue. I got up while still on the phone and closed the window. I said at the beginning it was an incident, but because neither the school nor the victims filed charges, the police were never involved. So you see, those involved were very reluctant to talk, regardless of there being a victim who had one eye beaten so badly that it had been had permanent damage. It could have been the school or possibly some individual who made arrangements to keep this from going public. Also, the psychologist was very strict about the professional ethics. Hello? Marubara-san? Can you hear me? There was the figure of a person standing by the light near the mailbox this whole time. Even in this torrential rain, they didn't have an umbrella. They were questionably drenched from head to toe. In this shower, which more resembled a waterfall, droplets of water dripped down from her hair. Just standing there, both arms dangling at her side. In one hand was a stack of boxes wrapped in cloth. Her eyes focused on my room, focused on me as I was about to close the window. Her mouth was methodically repeating a chewing motion. It was as if she was chewing something hard in her mouth, her cheeks puffing out. What could she be eating over there? How could it be at this time I was more enthralled by Raina instead of the shocking developments being brought to light by Oishi-san? If I hadn't started raining, I wouldn't have gone to the window. I wouldn't have noticed Raina, nor would I have noticed that. Raina's mouth was moving in the same pattern. She wasn't eating something, she was repeating something. What was it? Was she repeating to me? What was she saying? Why was I right up against the window, fixated on her? Hello? Marubara-san! Can you hear me? Hello? I'm sorry. Marubara-san! I'm sorry.
Oh, no.
Hello? Marubara-san! What's the matter? Even this torrential downpour, Raina was still apologizing. The other self inside me drew the curtain hastily with my right hand, blocking my view of the outside. Even doing that, Raina's relentless apology still reached my ears. I'm sorry, I'm sorry, I'm sorry. I'm sorry. If I forgive you for this, will you forgive me for that? Please stop. Please stop. Please stop. Please stop. I'm sorry. 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 Damn it! Why did I have to forgive her? I'm the one who wants to be forgiven. Well, pardon me, can't you forgive? I won't be killed. If you won't forgive me, then I won't forgive you either. I won't forgive. 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 Marbar-san, if you can't hear me, then please respond. Hello? I need to take off this hat.
No. 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 No.
Why?
No.
It's 2 a.m, Joey. We need to make a call or you can record another.
That was 1 hour and 30 minutes long.
We still have notes. Do we read the notes in this one or do we read the notes at the beginning of the next one?
I don't know because I don't know how long the next one's gonna be.
That's the longest chapter. That's been the longest chapter so far.
I think a shit ton
of things happen.
I think we should read them in the next one.
Yeah, you're right. Alright.
Sorry for the long one.
Yeah, sorry or not, maybe you liked it, maybe you didn't, I don't know. But holy shit.
There is so much that happened in one episode.
What chapter is this? What chapter is this? This is chapter... There's 2 more chapters! How is there 2 more chapters?
I think maybe the next chapter is the climax. The last chapter is like the fallout or aftermath. I don't know.
Yeah.
But whatever happens, we hope you guys tune in for the next episode.
Because shit's right there at the fan.
I think shit hit the fan.
No, shit is right there at the fan.
Dangling.
It's just like right here.
Oh my gosh, we gotta stop with the shit hitting the fan metaphor. Okay, we'll see you guys in the next one. Bye.
Bye, guys.